Hello, good evening, everyone. Welcome to Grade Up. I'm Vikas Bhadauria, and I welcome you all to the lecture on energy and its conservation. So, as you all know that Grade Up has started these e-engineering services classes for 2020 exam, and in that we are providing some lecture for GS, that is General Studies and Engineering Aptitude. And so, in that classes today we are going to start another subject of basics of energy and environment. Okay, so I will be taking this subject and I will try to cover this subject in 5 to 6 classes. Okay, and as you all know that engineering services examination will be conducted on 5th of January, and all those students who have applied for this exam and who are preparing for this exam, this is our effort for everyone so that you guys can have at least you should have information, and we'll try to cover the important topics which will be sufficient enough for your in this 4 to 5 classes. We'll try to cover as much as possible. Okay, we'll try to give as much as content as possible for the engineering services 2020, which will be conducted on 5th of January next year. So yes, very good evening, Pawan Kalyan. I also miss you, and Rohit Sharma. So last time we met in the rank up gateami in the subject of thermodynamics and applied thermodynamics. And good evening to everyone, Rishabh Patil, Rohit Sharma. This mock test for ISRO will be discussed at 6:30 p.m. Mega mock will be discussed today at 6:30 p.m. So you have to wait till that time. All right. Now, before I start the subject, I have to tell you this thing, that I have taken total 5 to 6 lectures for this environment, basics of energy environment. But you have to understand, it's not possible to cover each and everything in this 4 to 5 lectures. That too, if you are preparing for engineering services examination. Okay, but I will try to cover the best possible content. I will try to cover the topics in the best possible way, so that if the question will come from these topics of energy environment, you would be confident that you will have a concept of these basic understanding of the these topics of energy environment. Okay, so energy and its environment, basics of energy and environment has been divided into 5 lectures that I'll be taking. The first lecture is energy and its conservation. Okay, so it's my request to everyone, please try to attend the lecture very patiently, because it will be you will be reading some new things here. And most of you must have studied this thing in your BTEC or in your graduation, because it is mentioned in the syllabus of UPSC that all these 5 topics are actually all these 10 topics total, they are actually basics engineering that you all have covered in your graduation. Okay, so we'll not go into the detail. All right, before I start the lecture, this is a brief information about myself. You can see here I have total that everything is given about me, total 5+ year teaching experience with M.Tech in thermal engineering, and I have mentored more than 50,000 students. And area of expertise, you can see fluid mechanics, thermal and applied, and heat transfer, that is my area of expertise. Well, Rohit Sharma, if we talk about the weightage of environment, you can see this, if you see the syllabus, there is no as such weightage of this subject. These 10 topics which are mentioned for this paper 1 of prelims for GS and engineering aptitude, for these 10 topics basically 5 to 15% is the weightage for each and every topics. So for some topics they can ask you 15%, for some topics they can ask question they can have a weightage of 5%. Okay, so it totally depends on UPSC that what is the weightage given to that particular topic. Okay, so there are total 10 topics including engineering, energy, environment, from which the question will be asked in the paper 1 prelims of engineering services 2020. Okay, now before we start discussing the energy environment, the first lecture is on energy and its conservation. What is energy? Energy is, as you all know, it is a capacity to do work. Okay, and so we'll not go into the definition of this thing. And the classification, the major classification of the energy is primary energy. It is used for direct consumption like industrial heating or industrial heat generation or internal combustion engine. And secondary energy is the energy when the energy resources are used to generate electricity. Okay, so primary energy and secondary energy, these are the two types of energy basically. Primary energy is that energy which we directly use for our day-to-day life consumption, like for internal combustion engine and for industrial heating. Okay, so that is called primary energy. For example, heat. Heat energy is that low-grade energy you all have studied in thermodynamics, right? So it is a low-grade energy, and that low-grade energy is the primary energy that we always, that is for, you know, that for industrial heating, for internal combustion engine, that is required, we require primary energy, okay? And when this primary energy is converted into high-grade energy, that is electricity or work, then it is called secondary energy. Okay, I have taken something from thermodynamics, second law of thermodynamics, that primary energy basically the heat energy. It is available in nature, right? And you have to harness that energy, you have to convert that energy into secondary energy, which is work. And that is the useful work that is converted into electricity. Okay. Now, other classification of the energy is conventional and non-conventional energy. Conventional energy is basically, they are fossil fuel energy, hydropower energy, and nuclear power. These are conventional. Conventional means the resources of energy which you cannot reuse again. You cannot reuse these resources of energy. Those are called conventional. Or we can say traditional energies. Okay. But non-conventional energies are those energies which can be reused again and again. Okay, so you can see this diagram. You can see in conventional we have fossil fuel, nuclear power, hydropower. Okay, because these are conventional energy. And in the non-conventional we have solar energy, wind energy, geothermal, tidal, biomass, shale gas and syngas. Okay. Another classification of the energy is, yeah, traditional, or we can say conventional, that we have been using for a long time. For example, if you talk about this fossil fuel are basically as a result of millions of years of dead remains of plants and animals. They give you coal and this fossil fuel. Okay, so these are conventional. Okay, we can say traditional. Renewable and non-renewable is another classification. Okay. Now, in this classification, we have non-renewable. Non-renewable means the energy resources which cannot be renewed. That is called non-renewable. Example is fossil fuel, nuclear power, shale gas and syngas. Okay, these are those resources of energy that cannot be reused again and again. That cannot be reused or renewed. Okay, but renewable energy are those energy which the source of this energy is not going to extinct. They will remain forever. For example, hydropower, wind energy, solar energy. The source of these energies is sun. And you know that the sun will always remain forever. It is going to give you this energy in the form of the heat. And it's so the solar energy is the source of all the renewable energies. Basically, hydropower, solar, wind, geothermal, tidal, and biomass. Okay? Yes, what is your doubt? Can you please? Yes, what is your doubt? See, I can understand this. These lectures are going on the YouTube channel. And anyone can access this lecture, anyone can watch this lecture, but it's my request. Only those students who are serious for engineering services, they should only attempt this lecture. Otherwise, you guys can, there is no need for attending the lecture. You can go from here. Okay. Yes. Don't need to discuss these stupid things here. Okay. Yes. So if we classify these energies, non-renewable energy, we have basically fossil fuel energies. Okay, and nuclear energy. In that fossil fuel, we have coal, petroleum, natural gas, shale gas, coal bed, methane and syngas. These comes under fossil fuel. In the nuclear, we know that source of nuclear energy is basically the radioactive materials, that is uranium, thorium and thermonuclear material. Okay, in the renewable source of energy, we have classification in the form of biofuel and abiotic resources. Okay, in the biofuel, we have biomass, biogas, bioethanol and biodiesel. In the abiotic resources, what is the meaning of biotic and abiotic? biotic, which means related to living things, abiotic, which related to non-living thing. Okay, so the source of these energy is non-living things. Okay, for example, hydro energy, geothermal energy, solar energy, wind energy, hydrogen and ocean energy. Okay, so these are the major classification of non-renewable and renewable. Okay, now the solar energy, firstly let us discuss about the solar energy. The solar energy can be utilized in two ways. One way is to directly utilize the heat of the solar energy and to utilize that heat for the heating purpose. Okay, other way is for converting that solar energy directly into electricity. So basically you can see that the solar energy can be by collecting the radiant heat and using it in a thermal system, you can utilize it for water heating, swimming pool heating, space heating and cooling, and you can also use it directly for converting into electricity. So these are the two ways in which you can utilize the solar energy, by converting the energy into electricity or you can directly use it for heating. Okay, now the former, the first application is referred to as solar thermal system. The devices which are based on the utilization of solar energy and based off are called as solar thermal system, okay, which directly utilize the heat of the solar energy, and the devices in which the solar energy is directly converted into electrical energy are called solar photovoltaic devices. Solar photovoltaic devices are those devices in which the solar energy is directly converted into electrical energy. Okay. Now, the source of this all this other kind of energy like wind energy, biomass energy, tidal energy, ocean energy, or we can say wave energy and ocean thermal and hydro energy is actually sun. The sun is the main source of all these energies in wind, biomass, tidal, ocean, wave. Okay, so we'll discuss about them. Now, solar thermal system, basically the application, if you see the devices in which solar thermal system is basically used, the principle of solar thermal system is that directly the solar energy, the heat of the solar energy is concentrated with the help of a solar collector. Basically, they use a solar collector. There are different types of solar collectors that can be concentrating collector or non-concentrating collector. You must have those who are from South India. There are some temples in the South India which use solar cooker. Okay, so this solar cooker is used for cooking in some temples in South India. There's a famous temple. I don't know the name of that temple. So you all have seen the application there. They use parabolite dish collector for concentrating the solar radiation, and for that by utilizing that solar energy they are used for cooking purpose. Okay, so that is the application of solar cooker. Similarly, you can use it for solar passive space heating and cooling system. You can also use it for solar water heater, for solar refrigeration and air conditioning. Okay, I have taught this refrigeration air conditioning subject. In that I have told you that vapor absorption refrigeration system are basically based on solar refrigeration. Okay, so in solar refrigeration and air conditioning we use solar thermal system application. Then we have solar dryer, solar distillation and solar thermal water pump. Yes, the PDF will be available. That was promised to you, that PDF and quiz of this lecture will also be available to you. Okay, so these are the application of solar thermal system, and you can see this solar water heater. You all have seen such kind of source of solar water heater. If you have seen this, that's really good. So this kind of installations shows solar water heater. Okay, so the cold water will be given from one side, okay, and the hot water will be taken from the other side, and these are the concentrator. You can see this kind of, these are the blue, which are in blue color, they are concentrator. Okay, so they concentrate the energy of the solar energy is concentrated here, and that is used to boil the water, and that hot water is basically supplied for the other side. Okay, yes Sagar, what is the question? Sir, if sun is renewable energy, then why do we power plant the use sun as a source? Is yeah, please don't have this stupid question. We are all engineers, try to have a discussion which is good, okay, and don't have this kind of question. See, sun, we can utilize the sun in the solar thermal energy in the sun. There are some power plant which are based on the solar energy. There are some power plant, but that we cannot fully utilize the solar energy for power plant. Why? Because the solar energy is also affected by climatic condition. Okay, they are only it is available only some part of the day. Okay, so and it is also affected by climatic condition. During rainy days, we don't have the sufficient supply of the sun. So that is why we cannot use that as a source of energy for power plant. Directly not we cannot use that. Okay, we can store that energy, and that energy can be used for power plants. Okay, so such kind of power plant is also there. And you can see some power plant in Rajasthan, which are super thermal power plant based on solar energy. Okay. Now solar water heater, if you see the working, you can see the cold water is supplied to the storage tank, and the solar collector placed here. The solar collector have a device called they have a material called as absorber. That absorber will absorb the solar radiation, and the cold water is supplied from this side. That cold water goes into the solar collector, and in the solar collector, when they absorb the heat of the sun, that water will get heated up, and the hot water is supplied again back to the storage tank. So this storage tank will contain the hot water that can be utilized for your right now we have this winter season, so you can utilize this solar water heater, and you can save electricity. Why do we use solar water heater? What is the use of renewable energy? We can save the electricity, right? Because the coal and fossil fuel, they are conventional source of energy, and they also consume lot of energy. Yes. Yeah, don't have these stupid comments here. It's my request. Yes, photovoltaic cell directly converts the solar energy into electricity. If we have to convert the solar energy directly into electricity, we use photovoltaic cell. So the previous one was solar thermal system. In the solar thermal system, we are converting the solar energy into heat energy. Okay, and that heat energy was utilized for solar heating system. Okay, for example, solar water heater. The other application is photovoltaic system. In the photovoltaic system, the solar energy is directly converted into electricity. You all have seen such kind of installation in some colleges and in some commercial buildings. Such kind of installation you must have seen. These are called as solar panels. They are called solar panels. So when the energy from the sun fall onto this solar panel, they absorb the solar energy, and the solar panel basically consists of a semiconductor material. And this semiconductor material consists of this N junction and P junction. And what happens here, the electrons and the whole transmission will take place, and due to which the electricity will be flow. The stored electricity, this electricity which will flow due to solar panel, will be stored in this battery. Now this battery has got this DC power. Now this DC power, it will be converted with the help of an inverter into AC, and that can be supplied with the help of a meter for different application, for home appliances and also for providing the electricity to the grid. Okay, that is one of the application which is called solar photovoltaic system. Okay, yes, all right. You can see this kind of solar PV panels. You must have seen this kind of installation in some buildings and in your colleges and in your nearby homes. Okay, so basically this is the utilization of solar energy with the help of solar photovoltaic panels. Okay. Now, what are the advantage of solar energy? This solar energy, the question directly comes in the exam from advantage of solar energy. If you have seen the previous year 2019 paper for engineering services, there was a direct question from limitation of solar energy. We will discuss that question in this lecture also. The class will be for around 2 hours. So we'll try to wrap up the lecture till 5:30, because we have another session at 6:30 today. Advantage of solar energy. Solar energy is basically free. First advantage is that it is free and renewable source of energy. And the second advantage is that it does not cause pollution. Sorry. It is not having any harmful emissions. Okay, so it is pollution free. It is free source of energy. It is pollution free. You can store it for different, you can use it for other application. It is noiseless. It does not cause noise pollution. Okay. While if you see this solar cells used to for power generation cause no noise. They are not causing any noise. But generators or turbines, they cause noise pollution. Okay. See, these advantages are directly asked in the exam. So please don't ignore it. Okay. The solar energy is free and renewable source to generate electricity, but it requires collectors and some other equipment for conversion of solar energy into electrical energy. Okay, it is free, it is less costly. It does not cause any pollution, right? Thermal power plant. The solar cell does not consist of any moving parts, and hence this requires a little maintenance, does not require much maintenance. And one more thing, it can be used in the remote areas for generating the electricity. Okay, so this question was asked this time in the 2019 paper, that what are the limitation of solar energy. So one of the limitation of solar energy is that you cannot transmit this energy from one place to another. You have to locally utilize that energy. Okay, so you can take it as an advantage, but this is also a limitation, that you cannot transmit this energy from one place to another place. You have to locally utilize that energy. Okay. Now coming to the disadvantage of solar energy. Solar energy entirely depends on sunlight duration. Okay. So if there is no sunlight, there is no solar energy. Okay. So during the cloudy days or during rainy season, rainy days, we don't have sufficient supply of the solar energy. So during that time, you cannot harness this energy. Okay, so that is mentioned here, the solar energy can be harnessed in a limited period as the sunlight is available only during the daytime and sunny days. This power can be generated only in the limited time period, but that can be stored in the batteries. It's not recommended to refer any book Vikram Bharadwaj, because right now if you go into any book, only 1 month is left for engineering services examination. That will not be, I will not recommend that, because only very less time is left for the exam. Okay, so it's better to refer to these lectures, and that is have been started by GridUp, and I hope it's going to help you for your exam. The battery used to store solar energy are very costly. Yes, they are very costly. Yes, Sakshi, the solar energy is very costly. The solar PV panels are not that much cheap. They are very costly. Okay. So battery used to store the solar power are very costly, huge size, and need to be replaced from time to time. Okay, that is one of the disadvantage. The efficiency of the solar power system. The solar power, the efficiency is only 22%. And there are more research is going on in this field of solar energy to convert this, to have a conversion efficiency of more than 30%. But so far only 30%, this efficiency of the solar cell is only 22% so far. Okay, so that is very less. Okay, so that is not much more, that is not efficient. Is solar energy AC or DC? See, basically, Sheikh Azhar, the electricity, the solar photovoltaic cell, the electricity that is generated in the solar photovoltaic cell comes in the form of a DC source. That DC source can be converted into the AC source with the help of an inverter. Okay, so yes, directly the energy in the battery is DC power, but that can be converted into AC with the help of an inverter. One more important information that can be asked in the exam, that in India, there is an institute called National Institute of Solar Energy, which is located in the Gurugram, Haryana. It is one of the top institute in our country for research and development in the field of solar energy. And that is located in Gurugram or Haryana. Okay, the current installed solar capacity in India is 31.69 gigawatt. That is the total current installed capacity of solar energy in our country. And that data is of year of the this time, that is 31st October 2019. This data was collected, that the total installed capacity of solar energy in our country is 31.69 gigawatt. Okay, and the solar energy that is received on the earth is only 1.4 kilowatt per meter square. That means the density of the solar energy on the earth is very, very less. And this is also called as solar constant. What is solar constant? The energy received on the earth per unit area is called as solar constant. And that is only 1.4 kilowatt per meter square. Okay. This National Institute of Solar Energy is an autonomous institute which was set up by Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, which is the apex center for research and development in the field of solar energy. Okay, and that was set up in September 2013. Okay, so this is some information about your current affairs, and that can also be asked in the exam. Okay, so you have to remember this National Institute of Solar Energy, the total installed capacity, and the solar constant thing. Okay. Yes, any question from this thing? Sir, solar cell maintenance is easy or not? Yes, we can say this maintenance of the solar cell is very easy as compared to the other thermal power plants, because solar cell does not contain any moving parts. They don't contain very heavy and bulky parts. So the maintenance is easy as compared to the conventional source of energy. Okay. Efficiency of the hybrid energy. Efficiency, yes, definitely the efficiency can be increased. The efficiency of the solar energy can be increased by combining this energy with other form of energy like wind energy, or even you can combine these two energies together, that is conventional and solar energy together. That can be used together also. Okay. Now hydrogen fuel cell. This is another question may come in the exam from fuel cell. What is a fuel cell? That is thermochemical energy. If the chemical energy is converted into electrical energy directly, if chemical energy is converted into electrical energy directly, that is called as fuel cell. Okay, so in the fuel cell, what is the difference between fuel cell and battery? Do you know the difference between fuel cell and battery? Yes. Can you tell me the difference between fuel cell and battery? Anyone? What is the difference between fuel cell and battery? How solar energy density is measured, by any instrument or by other tool? See, basically this solar constant, Sheikh Azhar, is having a fixed value of 1.367 or approximately 1.4 kilowatt per meter square. And this has been given by some, this is a fixed data, and that has been given by some, there are some devices for measuring the solar energy. Which are called like pyranometer and pyrheliometer, and also there's a device for measuring that that is called sunshine recorder. So there are different devices. For example, pyranometer, pyrheliometer. These are the two devices which are used to measure the radiation, total radiation falling onto the sun. That is called as pyranometer and pyrheliometer. There is also a device which is used to measure the total sunshine days in the year. Okay, which is also called sunshine recorder. So these are the devices which are used for measuring the solar radiations, okay, falling onto the earth. Understood? I don't think this question is going to be asked, because this is something more in detail, or this is something related to research field. But since you asked this question, that is why I have given you this. These are the three devices. Okay. Now, what is a fuel cell? Battery in chemical energy is converted into electrical energy. Is fuel cell in energy storage device? Yes. Basically, in the battery we store the electrical energy, but fuel cell is that energy storage device in which you can continuously convert the chemical energy into electrical energy. But this battery, you have to again recharge the battery again and again. You have to store the energy again and again in the battery. But there is no source for regeneration in the battery. You have to recharge it again and again. But in the fuel cell, the source of the fuel cell, as the word suggests, fuel cell. Fuel cell. Cell means, if you combine various cell, we will get a battery. Combination of cell gives battery. So fuel cell is a kind of a battery. We can say it is a kind of a battery which continuously produce electricity with the help of a fuel. Now that fuel can be hydrogen, that can be other kind of fuel. But if you use hydrogen as a fuel, hydrogen and oxygen, it is called as hydrogen fuel cell. Okay, so in the hydrogen fuel cell, we have one fuel as hydrogen, other fuels is oxygen. Oxygen is used as air, okay? And this hydrogen and oxygen combines together to give water and heat. So that is a basically reaction that takes place in the fuel cell. Now, what is the good thing about the fuel cell? You can see the reaction in the fuel cell. Hydrogen and oxygen combine together to give heat and water. Okay, so there is no pollutants which are produced in this reaction of the fuel cell. So we can say it is cleanest source of energy. It is cleanest source of energy because there is no harmful pollutants which are produced from the fuel cell. Like carbon dioxide, there is no carbon dioxide, there is no sulfur dioxide. It is only containing water and heat. Okay, so that is a good thing about the fuel cell. There is no emission from the fuel cell. So that is why these fuel cells are used for internal combustion engine. Nowadays, research is basically being done in this area, in which how we can utilize this hydrogen fuel cell in your internal combustion engine to replace the biodiesels, to replace the petrol and diesel. Why? Because petrol and diesel produce lots of pollutants, a lot of harmful pollutants, right? So that is creating the pollution. You can see that air quality index is also increasing. So that is why we are trying to have some research is going on in the field of fuel cell, that to hydrogen fuel cell. But the problem with hydrogen fuel cell is that hydrogen, the source of this fuel cell is hydrogen. Now this hydrogen is not available for free. Okay, you know that hydrogen is the lightest metal, and it is placed at first position in the periodic table, right? So hydrogen can only be get this hydrogen from steam reforming or electrolysis. Now, so firstly, if you have this hydrogen, you can easily convert with the help of hydrogen oxygen combined together. You can get this heat and water. Okay, so this is one of the advantage of fuel cell, that electricity can be produced with the help of hydrogen as a fuel, and that too it is not having any harmful pollutants. Okay, if you see the diagram of this fuel cell, basically it contains two. It is a kind of a battery. You can see it is containing two terminals. One is anode, other is cathode. Okay, anode is called the positive terminal. It is a positive terminal, and cathode is a negative terminal. Okay, so from this side we will have oxygen that will enter to this negative terminal, and to the positive terminal hydrogen as a fuel will enter to this side. Now when this hydrogen will enter from this side, it will dissociate into hydrogen ion. That hydrogen ion is a negative ion. Okay, so this negative ion will go on to the anode, which is a positive electrode, and the negative oxygen ion will go on to the cathode. Okay, so when these two combines together here in the electrolysis, they will produce water and heat. So I have already shown you the reaction for this, that hydrogen oxygen combined together to give water and heat. Okay, battery is chargeable, but sir, cell are not chargeable. Sir, do this happens? Okay, so I think today in this YouTube channel we have more of those students whose interest is not related to this engineering services preparation. So it's my request to everyone, I'm not angry on you. Please, you can go on to some other channel. Okay, what are the advantage of the fuel cell? The fuel cell technology offers high conversion efficiency. The conversion efficiency of the fuel cell is very, very high. There's a lot conversion efficiency from chemical energy into electrical energy. It provides modularity, compactness, and noise-free operation. The size of the fuel cell is very, very small. as a source of energy as compared to other sources of energy. Okay, application is it can be used in small power generation system. It can be used for your 2 and 3 wheelers, and it can also be used for catalytic combustion system for design, residential industrial system can be used. Okay, that is the advantage application of the fuel cell. Now the next important source energy is biomass energy. It is also a very important thing. And modularity, what does the mean of modularity? Modularity means it can be used for different application. It provides modularity. It can be used for heavy vehicles. It can be used for a small power generation set. So it is like we have this concept of modular kitchen, right? You can relate to that thing. So we are having everything at a small space. You are having everything in the small space. That is called modularity, and these two terms are actually related. Compactness and modularity are always related together. Okay, so if a system is compact, it will have some modularity. Okay, now another source of energy is biomass energy. And in this biomass energy, the question, if you see the previous year 2019 paper, the question has come from this biomass energy, okay, or biomass or biodiesel or biogas, the question comes from this topic, that is biomass. Okay, now what is biomass? Biomass is a renewable source of energy. The source of this energy is sun. So all the dead remains of plants, animals, and human excreta, they are together called as biomass. All the biodegradable material, that is it can be animal waste, it can be plant waste, all this waste material that can be recycled again, and it can be used for some application, that is called biomass. Now what is this biomass? It is commonly called plant matter growth to generate electricity or produce heat. Yes, there was also a numerical that was asked from biogas. So I have taken this question in today's session. So please be present till the end of the lecture, because that question I have taken as a last question. Okay, so for that you have to attend the lecture so that you can know how to solve such kind of question. All right. So biomass is basically commonly called plant matter growth. It can be plant matter growth. It can be animal waste also. So these are combined together and they are processed with the help of some anaerobic decomposition to give electricity. Now how the source of this biomass is sun? We know that solar energy is utilized for photosynthesis, and photosynthesis is the process from which the plants prepare their food. Okay. Now this plants becomes the biomass, and this biomass can be used for energy generation or for electricity production. Okay. Now what are the usable form of biomass? Like PM Sharma is having this question. The biomass can be used for different application. If you see the application of the biomass, the one of the major application of the biomass is biodiesel. This is also one of the important area of field for research that is used nowadays. You can see, this is your garbage that you normally throw from your houses. Okay, that garbage can be it can be sourced from wood, it can be a source of some crop, and it can be alcohol fuel, and this can be landfill gas. Okay, so these all five things are actually a type of biomasses. They are together, or they can be used for these application. For biodiesel, it can be used as a wood or charcoal. It can be used as a bioethanol. It can be used as a biogas or producer gas. Okay, so please, if you can have a close look on this application of the biomass, that is bio. So what are the application of biomass? You can see biodiesel. You know that the source of driving the these vehicles like 2-wheelers, 4-wheelers, like basically petrol and diesels, right? Now, or also some research is going on for hydrogen fuel cell. But these petrol and diesel have this problem of harmful emissions, right? Like they can have emission of carbon dioxide, they can have emission of hydrogen sulfide, and so many different pollutants get emitted by combustion of the petrol and diesel. Okay, so we are trying to utilize, we are trying to replace this petrol and diesel with other source of energy. Okay, now what are these alternative fuels? These are called as biodiesel. Okay, now this biodiesel is basically, it is converted into ethanol. This biodiesel can be converted into ethanol, that is ethyl alcohol, and methanol, that is methyl alcohol, and that can be used as a liquid fuels in the engines. Okay, so there are different grades of biodiesel, which are this, like B20, B100, okay. Next is bioethanol. Bioethanol, as I already told you, it is having a boiling point of 78 degrees Celsius. It is derived from wet biomass, like sugar cane. You can use this sugar cane for producing bioethanol, okay. It can also be taken from starches like grains and potatoes. Also the source, one of the sources, cellulose, like woody matters. Another application of biomass is biogas. Biogas is basically produced by anaerobic decomposition of the biomass. Anaerobic decomposition means when we decompose the biomass in absence of the air, that is called anaerobic decomposition or fermentation. So anaerobic fermentation of the biomass anaerobically to obtain a gaseous fuel is called a biogas. Now this biogas is basically used for cooking purpose. Nowadays government is doing a lot of things for providing this for avoiding the burning of fossil fuel. In you know that in most of the villages the main source of cooking was they used to just heat the wood materials, and they used to cook the food, right? They used to use some conventional method for cooking the food. But nowadays, government is trying to provide everyone some source of, for cooking purpose, they should use biogas, or they should use CNG. And so that is why, because the fossil fuel creates a lot of pollution. Okay, so to reduce the dependency of the village, the people who are living in the villages, we also use biogas. Biogas is also used for cooking purpose because of the low pressurized and highly inert fraction. It is used for mobile vehicles in large scale. It is also used for vehicles also, and also used for cooking purpose. Producer gas is produced by gasification. There are two terms. One is called fermentation, other is called gasification. These are the two terms. Okay. In the fermentation, the gas that we get is called biogas. In the gasification, the gas that we get is called producer gas. Now, this producer gas contains, along with methane, it also contains some pollutants like carbon dioxide. It also contains nitrogen. Okay, so this producer gas also contains, the major portion is methane. Along with that, it also contains carbon dioxide and nitrogen. Okay, it is produced by gasification of the solid fuels. Generally used in intake stroke with air to reduce 85% of the quantity of the diesel required for combustion. Okay, that is called producer gas. It is also used for in some of the vehicles we use it as an intake for the air. Okay, it is used for combustion process in the vehicles. The biomass, there are other resources of biomass, like it can be a forest residue, it can be agriculture residue. Okay. It can also be crop residue, standing biomass. Standing biomass means like some briquettes and pellets. What is briquettes and pellets? Briquettes and pellets are basically, these are solid wood pieces. Solid wood pieces are called as briquettes and pellets. They are having some different shapes. So it can be standing biomass. It can be biomass energy plantations. Okay, so these are one of the sources of biomass. Other source are energy crops. There are some crops which are called as energy crops, like sugar cane. A sugar plant is also directly used for ethanol production. Other are sweet sorghum, sugar beet. These are also called as energy crops. Apart from that, we have some starch plants like artichoke, cassava, grains, etc. There are other some plants like for energy production, like sunflower oil, palm oil, castor oil, soybean oil, and groundnut oil. The main source of biodiesel. Biodiesel is also produced from these energy producing plants like sunflower, palm oil, castor oil, and soybean oil. Okay, groundnuts. All right. Some urban waste and municipal waste can also be used for this as a source of biomass. Now, what is biogas? Biogas is a flammable fuel with 60% of methane. Like I told you, that major proportion of in biogas is methane. Now, this, when you will be solving the question, in that numerical, they have given you the percentage of methane. So, 60% of the methane is present in the biogas, and rest is carbon dioxide. We don't want carbon dioxide in the biogas, but it comes from a decomposition process. That is the process from which biogas is produced, right? So, we have to reduce this percentage of carbon dioxide, and that can be done with the help of some water scrubbing methods. Water scrubber is basically used to reduce the pollutants, okay? And if we have to reduce the percentage of the carbon dioxide, we use water scrubber to provide pure methane. If you don't want carbon dioxide in the biogas, you can use water scrubbing, okay? Biogas typically refers to a gas produced by the biological breakdown of the organic matter in the absence of air. This process is also called as anaerobic, that is given here, anaerobic digestion or anaerobic fermentation. So this question can be asked, maybe they can ask you this question. The process from which biogas is produced is called anaerobic decomposition or fermentation. That is the process from which biogas is produced, okay? And it basically contains methane and carbon dioxide. And if it is produced by gasification of wood, from gasification of the wood, if you are doing gasification of the biomass, then the gas which we get is called as producer gas. That is called producer gas. The gas which is produced from gasification of the biomass is called producer gas, and the gas which is produced from anaerobic digestion or fermentation is called as biogas. Okay, and what are the composition of producer gas? The main composition are nitrogen, hydrogen, carbon monoxide, and some amount of methane. All right, understood everyone? Now, what are the application of the biofuel? Biofuel can be used as a fuel for ethanol and butanol, and it can also be used for biodiesel. Okay, you all know about this. I have told you the application. PDF, Kishan Kumar, PDF will be provided to you. And if you have seen those who are in the app, you will get the access for the PDF. Okay, that will be provided to you after the lecture. So these are the application of the biofuel ethanol. It can be used for as an additive for petrol and diesel. It can be used as a blend at low blend up to 10%. It can be mixed with the petrol and diesel. It is mixed with the diesel. That is why it is called biodiesel. Okay. So it is blended with fossil diesel and in the pure form. Now, what are the advantages of biomass? This question also comes in the exam. Advantage of solar energy and biomass is important. They have asked question directly from the advantage of biomass and solar energy. So it is a renewable source of energy. The energy storage is in. You can see that all the advantages are given here. Okay, so please, blended means, what is the meaning of blended here? Basically, Manpreet Kaur, blended means they are combined together. We cannot use pure biodiesel. We cannot use pure biodiesel for your vehicles. Why? Because the efficiency of the biodiesel is not that much like your diesel and petrol. So always we don't directly use pure diesel in the vehicles. We always combine this biodiesel with the diesel, or we combine this biofuel. We combine this biofuel with the diesel fuel. And that is called as blending. Blending together two different fuels is called as It is called blending basically. So we are combining biofuel, the fuel that we are getting from this decomposition of the energy crops like sugarcane, or it can be jatropha, or there are some different energy crops. So we are combining the biodiesel with the diesel. We are blending it together. And that is why you have seen the composition. It is also called as B20. It can be B100. It can be B30. What is the meaning of this thing? If you, they are different, how they are, the biodiesel are represented by this nomenclature. The meaning of this B20 or B100 or B30 is that in the total composition, the biodiesel, only 20% of, what will be there? 20% of the biofuel will be there and rest will be diesel fuel. Okay, because we cannot use 100% of the biodiesel, because the biodiesel is not having that efficiency to run the vehicle. Okay, so we always combine this biofuel with the diesel fuel. We cannot use it individually. Okay, so we have to combine it together. We cannot use the biodiesel in the pure form. Okay, so these are the advantages of biogas. You can see here, advantage of biomass. It is a renewable source. The energy storage is the main thing, is the major one. The major advantage of the biogas is that the pollutant emission from the combustion of the biomass are usually lower than that the fossil fuel. If you are burning directly the fossil fuel and if you are burning the biomass, the pollutants will be less. There will be less pollution. Okay. Commercial use of biomass may avoid or reduce the problem of waste disposal. So if we are using the biomass commercially, then the main advantage of using the biomass commercially is that basically we can reduce the municipal waste, or in the urban center, in the cities, if you are utilizing the waste which you are discarding from your homes in the cities, in the urban area, then that waste can be utilized somehow for some other application. Okay. Use of the biogas plants, apart from supplying clean gas, also leads to improved sanitation, better hygienic conditions in the rural area. And so these are some of the advantages. And if you want, you can take the picture of this, and you can also, you will get the notes of this advantage of the biomass and disadvantage in the PDF notes also. So these are the limitation. The question can come from the limitation of the biomass. Low concentration of the biomass per unit area of the land. So basically you cannot have this installation of the biomass plant for a large area. It is only limited to a particular small area. Okay, for example, if you have to, if you see these the major centers of the biomass, or if you have seen the biogas plant, they are not spread over a large area. Okay, so low concentration of the biomass per unit area of the land, that is the limitation. Okay, other limitation is that collection and transportation of the biomass is expensive due to high moisture content. Okay, so that is one of the limitation of the biomass. Cost of the energy production in the urban area is high. In the village area and the rural area, this electricity production of from biomass is less as compared to in the urban area. Okay, large land area is required in the urban area, so that cost will also will get high. Disadvantage of the biogas, we have seen the limitation. So similarly, it is disadvantage also. They are almost same. It is a dispersed and land intensive resource. It's often low energy density. The energy density is also very less. Okay. So these are the one of the disadvantages. It's also labor intensive, because manual labor is also lot of people are required for this conversion of biomass into other different products. So it is basically labor intensive, and the cost of collecting the large quantity for commercial application is significant. Okay, so these are the disadvantage and not feasible to set up at all locations. I hope you understood the disadvantage. I cannot read it all the disadvantage, but the major disadvantage of this biogas is that it is basically not available at all the location. You cannot set the biogas plant at all the location. Okay, because in the urban area, the cost of the land is very, very high. So if you are setting a biogas plant, it is going to have a lot of cost. Okay, And it is also labor intensive. Lot of human or manpower is required for carrying out the activity of converting biomass into biogas. Okay, so these are the disadvantage. Now there are some biomass energy programs in India. They can ask you question from this topic, because so far they have not asked any question from biomass energy program. But there are some biomass energy program like biogas development program, national program on improved chula, integrated rural energy program, village energy security program, and remote village electrification program, and Urja Gram. These are the six major biomass energy programs in the India. So you can note down the names of them, and maybe you get this in the notes, that's good enough. But if you don't, you can click a picture of this. Okay, now if we see biogas development program, it basically consists of national project on biogas development program. It was started in 1981-1982, and the objectives of that were mitigating the drudgery of the rural women. Drudgery means basically, we know that rural women used to do a lot of hard work. Okay, so to reduce the hard work of the rural women, basically that program was set up, which is called National Project on Biogas Development. Providing fuel to rural household for cooking purpose, organic manure for application in the agriculture field, recycling human waste by linking toilet with biogas plant. Okay, and it is basically used for sanitation. That is the objective of the present central government, to provide proper sanitation, to provide toilets all over the country. Next is community and institutional biogas plant program. It also comes under that biogas development program. The main objectives are to recycle the human waste through linking of toilets with biogas plant for improving the sanitation, to provide benefits of biogas technology to weaker section of the society, to recycle the organic waste for harnessing fuel gas at community and institutional level for various usages. Next is research and development in the biogas sector. This is the third major, this comes under biogas development program. It used for minimizing the capital cost of the biogas plant. So basically research and development in the biogas sector is also used. And so it is basically used for all the energy, renewable energy, to have a R&D center or R&D sector, because research and development is always required in any field of energy, because we always try to have some new technology and to minimize the capital cost. Okay, it provides studies in the field of microbiology, biochemistry, and engineering for increasing biogas at low and high temperature. Okay. Next is National Program on Improved Chula. This was started in the year 1986 to 1987, and the objectives were checks on deforestation and environmental protection. That was National Program on Improved Chula, because we know that what is the meaning of improved chula? We know that in the village area or in the rural area, normally the cooking was done with the help of that forest. They usually used to cut the woods from the forest, and they used to use for the traditional chulas. Okay, so there's a program called National Program on Improved Chula, and that is basically used to check on deforestation, that is cutting off the trees, and environmental protection, reduction of the health hazard and cooking time, and provides employment opportunity to rural people. That is also one of the objective. And more than 30 models of durable fixed with chimneys and portable improved chulas are available for family, community, and commercial application. Okay. Next is Integrated Rural Energy Program. This program was conceptualized during 6th 5-year plan, but was launched in the 7th 5-year plan. Though this question can be asked in the exam, that Integrated Rural Energy Program was launched in which 5-year plan? 7th 5-year plan. Okay, and the objectives are provision for the most cost-effective mix of various energy sources, and the option for meeting the requirement of sustainable agriculture and rural development by giving due weightage to environmental consideration. Okay, development of capability in the state and union territory for implementation of block level energy plan and projects. So you have to remember these points, because directly they ask you question from these points in the exam. Next is Village Energy Security Program. In this program, All energy needs of the villages such as domestic, commercial, agriculture, industrial will be met by local available biomass source of energy. That is under village energy security program. So what you can do, you cannot remember each and everything. You can have some, you can remember some points from each biogas development program or biomass development program set up by Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. Okay. This program is run by implementing agencies such as Forest Department, Department of Rural Development and reputed NGO. Next is Remote Village Electrification Program. The Remote Village Electrification Program aims to provide basic facility of lightning electricity in those unelectrified areas where grid connectivity is either not feasible or not cost effective. Okay. Next is Urjagram. This is the sixth biomass development program, which is called Urjagram. Urjagram is a project which aims to make remote and far-flung area. What is the meaning of far-flung area? The far-flung of the village, rural area, which are very far away from the cities. Okay. To make them self-sufficient in the energy through locally available renewable sources such as solar, bio and wind energy. Okay. The energy produced can be used not only for domestic needs but also for agriculture operation, cottage industry. In Urjagram, a community biogas plant may be there. Okay, so I hope all these points are clear to you, because they may ask you question from these biomass development program also. Okay, now since this topic is about energy and its conservation, we have studied I have given you brief information about some energy, different types of energy like solar energy and biomass energy, hydrogen as a fuel, as a energy. And so far the question has come from solar energy and biomass energy. That is why I have given you some brief information about solar energy and biomass energy. Okay. Other is energy conservation. What is the purpose of energy conservation? Why do we need to conserve the energy? Yes. Just read it carefully. Why do we need to conserve the energy and how we can conserve the energy? Yes, everyone. What is the purpose of conserving the energy? If we know that, it is a normal thing. Like if you are living in with your family, most of the time your father or your mother must be telling you that please switch off that fan. Please switch off that light if you are not in that room. Okay, you have to switch it off, right? And that is your duty and responsibility. You have to conserve the energy. Conserving the energy basically means increasing the you have to try some ways to reduce the energy consumption, because this energy is not available free, because all the conventional source of energy are very costly. Because they depends on this coal and natural gas or oil as a source of energy, as a source of fuel, and that are very, very costly. So we should try to minimize that, our energy consumption. And how we can do that? We can do that by installing this CFL bulb. There are a lot of TV ads that normally goes on that you have to use compact fluorescent lamp, which is also called CFL bulb. You can lower the room temperature. If you lower the room temperature, electricity consumption can be reduced. You have to maximize the daylight. Like for example, this is the winter season. And so in most of the areas of our country, during the daytime, we have sufficient supply of sunlight, right? So sufficient sunlight is available. So what you can do, you can have some maximum daylight. You can switch off all the lights during the day. You can save the electricity, right? Use energy efficient application and switch off the devices when not in use. So this, I don't think this is something which I need to teach you, because you all know how to conserve the energy, how to conserve the electricity. Okay, because all these sources of energy, either it is biomass energy or hydrogen energy or any kind of solar energy, the main purpose or the main output of this energy is electricity. Major output is electricity. And if we have to conserve that electricity, that I think that should be taught to you. You should understand that we have to conserve the electricity. We have to switch off the light. We have to switch off the fan if you are not sitting in that area. Okay, we have to switch off the AC. We should not use the AC because using the AC for a long time is going to increase release the CFC in the atmosphere that is going to have ozone layer depletion, the problem of ozone layer depletion. Okay, in the coming lecture of engineering services, I will be taking the lecture of environmental pollution and degradation. In environmental pollution degradation, we will be studying about air quality index and water pollution, air pollution. So there you will come to know that how we are increasing the air and water pollution. We are together, we have to stop that. Okay, so there are different energy ratings given in our country for our buildings and for our the places where we study, where we live. Basically, that there are two energy ratings, our green building ratings. What is green building ratings? What is green building rating? So nowadays, there is a concept government is planning for this, that most of the newly constructed buildings and commercial buildings, they should have the green building certificate. What is green building certificate? The green building certificate basically is the certificate which certifies a building that the complete design, operation, maintenance, installation and working of that building will be related to conserving the electricity or will be for energy conservation, will be based on energy conservation. Okay, so basically it consists of, it includes a set of rating system for the design, construction, operation and maintenance of the green building. Green building means the energy saving building. Those buildings which should save the energy. How we can save the energy? By reducing the carbon credit. By not depending on electricity. We should try to avoid use of electricity as much as possible. How we can do that? We can design our home like that. We can design our home for solar passive heating and cooling. What is solar passive heating and cooling? Solar passive heating and cooling means you can design your window or we can design the house in such a way so that you can get sufficient sunlight during the winter season so that you should not use any other devices like blower or heater and your house should get naturally heated. Similarly, during the summer season, you should get sufficient fresh air from the outside and so that you don't use your AC or your fan. Okay, so these building, these are the green building ratings, and there are two building ratings which is called leadership in energy and environmental design, which is also called LEED, and the other building rating is called as GRIHA. These are the two building ratings, LEED and GRIHA, and these are given basically for green building. These are the green building certificate. This is the Indian certificate. This is given by within our country, and this is the green building certificate which is at global standard. So this is a difference between these two types of green building certificate. One is called as based on global standard, that is given by US Green Building Council. It was developed by US Green Building Council, but the other one is developed within our own country. This is our Indian certificate for green building, which is also called green rating for integrated habitat assessment, which is also called GRIHA. Okay, so LEED and GRIHA are the two green building certificate which one is within our country and another is outside our that is global standard. Okay, so GRIHA is also a rating tool for the building. It helps people assess the performance of the building against certain nationally accepted benchmarks. It is used to evaluate the environmental performance of a building over entire life cycle and providing standard for green building. Understood everyone? So these are the two certificates. One is based on Indian certification, other is based on global certification. Now another two things that I have to tell you is shale gas and coal bed methane gas. Okay, shale gas and coal bed methane gas are basically The major constituent of these kind of gases is methane. They contains natural gas as a major constituent. Okay. Now the shale gas and coal bed methane gas is basically the natural gas which is produced from sedimentary shale rock formation. The gas which is trapped within sedimentary shale rock formation is called as shale gas. Okay. Shale gas is extracted by pumping high quantity of chemical. If you for extracting this kind of gases like shale gas and coal bed methane gas, what we do is we extract some just drill some wells inside the coal bed or in the shale rock formation. In that well, what we do, we drop some chemicals and water and sand. So when we drop that, the air from that, or we can say the gas from the rock formation, rises up with the help of a pump. Okay, so that is how we extract the shale gas from the rock formation or shale rock formations. Okay, by drilling a well into it. It is also called shale gas and has gained widespread popularity in recent year following the technological advances. So mostly till before 2011, India was not having any source of we have not discovered any source of shale gas, but that was majorly available in US. In USA, it is a leading producer of the shale gas, and most of the energy consumption of USA is depending on the shale gas. But in our country, in India, we have recently discovered 6 basins as the area for shale gas in 2011, and that is Cambay in Gujarat, Assam and Arakan in northeast, Gondwana in central India, Krishna Basin and Krishna Godavari Basin in the east coast, and Kaveri onshore and Indo-Gangetic basins. So India has also discovered 6 basins for shale gas, and but that was only discovered after 2011. Okay, before 2011, USA was the only. It is a major, basically USA is a major shale gas production country in the world. Okay. Next is coal bed methane gas. Coal bed methane gas is also called as, another name of coal bed methane gas is also called sweet gas or coal methane mining gas. It is also called coal methane mining gas. Sorry. Coal bed methane mining gas is also called sweet gas. What is the meaning of sweet gas? The natural gas which does not contain hydrogen sulfide. Natural gas which does not contain hydrogen sulfide is sweet gas, is called as sweet gas. Always remember this thing: if the gas does not contain hydrogen sulfide, then it will be called as sweet gas. And coal bed methane gas is also called as sweet gas because it does not contain hydrogen sulfide at the constituent in the methane. Basically, it consists of methane with minor amount of nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and heavier hydrocarbons like ethane. Earlier, the CBM was coal bed methane gas was wasted and vented out in the atmosphere during mining. We know that during the mining, some amount of gas is also released during mining, and this gas is actually trapped within the coal. Okay, so to extract that gas, what we do, we use some drilling wells into the coal block or the coal seam. The coal seam, basically, you must have seen some pile up of coal in the coal mines. Okay. So when we drill some hole in that coal block like this, you can see this is your coal, this is your coal seam. All the coal is accumulated here. So when we have drilled a well into this coal seam, what will happen? And we drop some water, then this gas, this coal bed methane gas, will naturally rise up from this side, and we can use a valve in this well, and this side can be closed and this side we can open this wall, and this gas, coal bed methane gas, can be supplied with the help of a pipeline to, and it can be stored. Okay, so this coal bed methane gas, the major major source or major constituent is methane. Okay, it can also contain some amount of nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and some heavier hydrocarbon like ethane. All right, that is the process of coal bed methane gas. Now the question can be asked in the exam from coal bed methane and shale gas is that this coal bed methane gas mainly consists of methane, but in the shale gas can also contain some amount of propane, butane. It can contain some amount of propane, butane also, but it mainly contains methane. Along with that, it can contain nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and it is also called a sweet gas because it does not contain hydrogen sulfide. Okay, so this was all in the theory part of this lecture of energy and its conservation. I have taken some energies for discussion, so I hope I have tried to explain these energies, like solar energy, what is solar energy, and different terms related to solar energy, like solar thermal system and solar photovoltaic system, what are the advantage application and this disadvantage of solar energy. Next we have discussed what is hydrogen fuel cell, what is biomass, biogas, application of the biogas, advantage, disadvantage and limitation, that is important. And next is we have discussed this coal bed methane and shale gas. Okay, so because we know that we cannot cover each and everything in 1 and 2 hours, so whatever was important from this topic, I have taken this. Okay, tomorrow we are going to study in environment and its conservation, so that is also a very important topic that we are going to cover tomorrow. And so let's discuss some question based on the topics that we have covered. Sorry, this is the first question. Hydrogen fuel cells. Now, question in the engineering services are not that much difficult question. The question are very simple. Whatever we have taught you here, the question will be almost from the same thing that I have taught you here. Or if you are going to, if you are studying anything, if you are referring some PDF notes or some book, the question will be directly from that theory only. But the thing is that if you see the question of engineering services, they are very confusing. They will give you 3 to 4 statements and they will ask you which of the following is correct out of the 3 to 4 statements given here. Okay. Basha, right now actually what is happening, Anwar Basha, maybe our team is working on the notes, or they will provide you notes by today evening. Please wait till 7 p.m. Definitely will provide you notes till 7 p.m. or today, by today only. Okay. Yes, everyone, please tell me the answer for this question. What is the answer for this question? Azhar Hussain is giving option B. Prakhar Shukla is getting option B. Yes, everyone, please tell me the answer for this question. Yes, for this question you can see a statement: hydrogen fuel cells are emerging as a fuel of the future due to its potential to address the energy crisis. Okay, now they are saying that you have to consider the statement given here. Okay, and you have to tell which of the following statements are correct. Now sometimes they ask you incorrect statement, sometimes they ask you correct statement. Now I can see Prakhar Shukla, Naresh, Smart Study, Swaraj Khatal is giving option C. Some of them are getting option B. Okay, so let's solve it. So I'm going to tell you the solution for this question. First statement is hydrogen fuel cell convert chemical energy into electrical energy. That is correct. Hydrogen fuel cell convert chemical into electrical energy. That means first is correct. Now that is quite sure that only 3 cannot be the right answer, because first is also correct. So this cannot be the right answer. Only 3 cannot be the right answer. Now second is, they are more environmental friendly as compared to other fuels like coal and natural gas. That is correct. Yes, they are environmental friendly because there is no pollution from hydrogen fuel cell. Next is, the only concern is the release of carbon dioxide. no, there is no release of carbon dioxide. That is not correct. This statement is not correct. There is no release of carbon dioxide, only release of water and heat. Okay, so only first and second statement is correct. And the right answer is option B. So those who have given option B as the answer, that is absolutely correct. Okay, very good. Next question. The LEED and GRIHA are green building rating system. They issue energy compliance certificate. They are referred to global standard or they are Indian standard under finalization. Which of the following is correct? So I'm giving you 1 minute. You can tell me the answer in the comment box. Yes, everyone, I have told you about this LEED and GRIHA in today's lecture only. So I want all of you to give the correct answer. Yes, so I can see Srijan Tripathi is giving option D, Naresh is giving option D, Vishnu, Azhar, Prakhar are getting option A. Deepak is getting option A, Ajitesh Gupta getting option D. Okay, so I'm going to tell you the solution. I have seen you, most of you have given option A and D. So let us check it. LEED and GRIHA are green building rating system. Yes, it is correct. That is, this first statement is correct. Okay. Second is, they issue the energy compliance certificate. Yes, they issue the energy compliance certificate. Does they refer to global standard? They are saying that both LEED and GRIHA refer to global standard. No, both LEED and GRIHA does not refer to global standard. Only LEED refers to global standard. Only LEED refers to global standard. I have told you this thing. Are Indian standard under finalization? No, they both are not Indian standard under finalization. Only GRIHA is Indian standard under finalization. So this cannot be true for both the things. So only first and second is correct. These two are not correct. So the right answer will be option A. So those who have given option A is absolutely correct. Next question. Consider the following statement regarding biogas, which is a very important source of energy in the rural area. First statement is biogas has a higher thermal efficiency compared to charcoal, cow dung and kerosene. Not only biogas serves as a source of energy in the form of fuel, but also can be used as a manure for farm crops. It is less environmental friendly as it releases greenhouse gases when it burns as a fuel. So which of the following statement is correct? Yes, read the statement carefully and tell me the right answer. Yes, thank you so much for your appreciation, Prashad. I'm very fine. I hope the same for you. Yes, everyone, please solve the question. One thing that you have to see here, in this question you have to tell the incorrect code, not the correct code. So be careful here. Don't have to tell the correct code, you have to tell the incorrect code. The timing of this lecture is at every day at 4 p.m. So every day at 4 p.m. we have this engineering services lecture from Monday to Friday. And this week we have a lecture on Saturday also. Yes. You have to tell the incorrect statement, not correct statement. Read the question carefully. So that is the thing that I was telling you about the engineering services questions. They can ask you incorrect code, they can ask you correct code. You have to focus on here. You have to focus on here, right? Because if you think that this is given correct code, then the answer will be different. Okay, so you be careful over this point. Especially when you are dealing with question of ESE, and that too this kind of question. Yes, so I'm going to tell you the answer. The right answer will be option C. The incorrect code is only option 3. Why? Because you can see the first statement is biogas has a higher thermal efficiency compared to charcoal, cow dung and kerosene. Yes, higher thermal efficiency, the amount of heat that we are getting as output. If we compare charcoal, cow dung and kerosene, yes, that is more. So thermal efficiency is more here. Okay. Not only biogas serves as a source of energy in the form of fuel, but also can be used as manure for farm crops. Yeah, that is also correct. We have seen that. There are different usage of this biomass. So that can be used as a farm crops also. Next is, LAS is slightly less environmental friendly as it releases greenhouse gases. No, we cannot say that it directly releases any greenhouse gases. Basically, biogas, the main constituent of the biogas is methane. The main constituent is methane. In the producer gas, yes, we have in the producer gas some amount of carbon dioxide, nitrogen. But if you are talking about the biogas is not. And it is, yes, it is environmental friendly. It is not any source of pollution for the environment. Okay, so it is environmental friendly. It is not less environmental friendly. It is actually environmental friendly because it mainly contains methane. Okay, it does not contain any pollutants. No, it is not with Aditya Srivastava. It is not with the biogas because in the biogas is not produced from combustion. It is from anaerobic decomposition. So when decomposition or fermentation take place, carbon dioxide is not produced. Okay, so in the biogas, basically we have methane as the major constituent in the biogas. Okay, it does not contain carbon dioxide. So the right answer is option C because it is not the correct. They are asking about the incorrect statement, so it is the incorrect statement. Next statement. Which of the following statements are correct about biomass? They are saying it is asking about the correct statement. Correct statement about the biomass. So you have to read the three statements carefully and tell me the right answer. Yes, have you solved it? It is not a difficult question. I can see everyone have you given the same answer, that is option D. Very good. So it is not a difficult question. You can see if you read the statements, biomass energy could be produced from industrial waste, agriculture, field, sewage, municipal solid waste. Yes. All these are the sources of the biomass. These are all comes under biomass. So the first statement is correct. Biofuel could be added to petroleum. Yes, they can be used added to the petroleum fuel like diesel and petrol. They can be added to that. Plants like Jatropha, neem, mahua and other wild plants. This is important. I have not told you about this thing. So there are some plants which are the source of the biodiesel. Okay, These are also called as energy plants. These are also called as energy plants. Like Jatropha, neem, mahua and other wild plants are identified as the potential source for biodiesel production in the India. Yes, that is also correct. So all these three statements are correct. The right answer is option D. Okay. Next question, with reference to the two non-conventional energy sources. These are the two non-conventional energy sources, like coal bed methane and shale gas. They are also called non-conventional because they are always they can be reused again. Okay, so they are also these two gases also come under non-conventional energy sources. Okay, this question can also be asked in the exam. So they are having two statements. You have to tell which of the following statements are correct. Yes, you have to tell which of the following statement is correct. See, I have taken these questions, some of the question, and these questions are directly from the topic that we have covered. And this, the only idea about this thing is the idea that I want to give here is, after going through the theory, after reading this topic that we have covered in this lecture, I hope most of you must have understood how to solve the questions, right? You must have got little bit clarity that how you can tackle the question which will be asked in the engineering services paper, right? So you have to read the statement very carefully. You have to read this thing also, which of the following statement is correct or not correct. You have to also read it here. All right. So I'm going to tell you the answer. I can see most of you are giving option A. Azhar Hussain is getting option D. All right. So let's see what is the right answer. First statement is coal bed methane is a pure methane gas extracted from coal seam. That is correct. This part is correct. But it is saying that while shale gas is a mixture of propane and butane only that can be extracted from fine-grained sedimentary rock. That is not correct. This part is not correct. Shale gas is a mixture of, it is basically contains methane, but it also contains propane and butane. But you cannot say that it contains only propane and butane. It is a mixture of different hydrocarbons, but the major hydrocarbon that is present in the shale gas is methane. Along with methane, we have propane and butane and other hydrocarbons. So this second part is not correct. So this part is not correct. Okay. In India, abundant coal bed methane sources exist. But so far, no shale gas sources have been found. That is also not correct. Second statement is also not correct. Why it is not correct? Because I have just told you that India has also discovered 6 basin for shale gas sources. I have told you that in the lecture. So India has also discovered 6 sources for shale gas in our country in different areas. Okay, so this statement is also not correct. First statement is correct. Second statement in this second statement is not correct. Okay, so both these two statements together are not correct. So neither one nor two is correct. Option D is the right answer. Only Prakhar Shukla, Shivam Rana, Azhar Hussain has given the right answer for this question. Understood, everyone? Those who have given option D as the answer, they are absolutely correct. Okay. So it's not that you can just read the two statements and you can give the answer. Even in this two statement, you can see first part is correct. Second part is not correct. First part is correct. Second part is not correct. So these are kind of some engineering services level question. Question are very simple and easy. But you have to read the question very carefully if you don't want to get negative marking. Simple. Next question. See, this I have taken three questions from ESC 2019 paper. Engineering Services 2019 paper. There were three questions, majorly there were three questions from in energy and its conservation from this topic. And this is the first question. They have directly asked, what are the limitation of solar energy? Only that is the, that was the question. What are the limitation of solar energy? Now there you can see, this question is so simple that even when I was attempting this question, I saw that very simple question. So you have, they have asked you the limitation of solar energy. They have given you three statements. You have to tell the correct answer using the code below. So tell me the right answer. You all have seen this question. Those who have solved the previous year. If you have not solved the previous year, please solve the previous year question, because they give you a good idea about the level of the questions. Yes. I know you guys have already, if you have seen the previous year question, if you have given the previous year ESC exam, you must have seen this question. So please give me the right answer. So without any discussion, I just want to give the right answer. See, first statement is collecting solar energy over large area and converting to other form can be conveniently transported, stored and used in existing equipment is not economical. Yes, this statement is correct. Collecting solar energy over large area and converting it to other forms is not economical, because solar energy density is very, very low. It is only available over small area. Okay. So you cannot transport the solar energy from one form to another. It is not economical. So this statement is correct. But they are not asking about the advantage. They are asking about the limitation. Right? That is the advantage. That is not the limitation. Second is, low density of solar energy as compared to coal, gas and coal, oil and gas. Sorry, low density of solar energy as compared to coal. Yes, low density of the solar energy. Density of the solar energy is low as compared to coal, oil and gas. We have just seen that solar energy, solar constant is only 1.4 kilowatt per meter square. The availability of solar energy is very, very less. The density of solar energy is less. Okay, so the second statement is also correct. The third statement is, its major application are. See, if even if you don't know the these statement, one thing you know, that here they are asking about the limitation, right? And here they are giving you the application. These two terms are not related to each other. Here they are asking about the, what are the limitation of the solar energy, and you have to give the correct code. And here they are saying that its major application are the photothermal conversion, solar heating, greenhouse technology. They are giving the application. You have to tell the limitation. What are the limitation here? Yes, what are the limitations? This cannot be the limitation. Only these two are the limitations here. These two are the limitation, one and two. So we can say the right answer is option B. Because they are not asking about the advantage. This is the application, guys. This is the application here. They are asking about the limitation. These two are the limitation. One and two are the limitation. So the correct answer will be option B. Because third one is the application. This cannot be the answer for limitation. Anything which is the application cannot be the limitation, right? So obviously the third one cannot be the answer. In all the three statements, A, C and D, option 3 is present. So these three cannot be the answer. Only answer can be option B. See, only from the statement you have got the answer. So these are the, you can see how simple the questions are. See, this question was, this came as a numerical. The last option is not visible. So I think I should, the last option is 48.6 megajoule per day. That is the last option, 48.6 megajoule per day. So these are the data which is given here, and this is normally not accepted, that question can come from numerical question can come from. So see, you can see they have mentioned the syllabus, like I told you, that anything can come from the basics of engineering. anything can come from the basics of engineering, what you have studied in your graduation. So they can be numericals, they can be theory, they can be anything. The syllabus is very, very vast. No one can guarantee that if I have taught you this much in this lecture, everything is going to come in the exam like that. You have to use your brain, you have to use the concept that you have studied in your BTech. Okay, what I am doing is I am just revising those concepts. I am just helping you to revise those concepts, right? In this question, they are giving that there is a biogas plant. There is a domestic biogas plant. In this biogas plant, they are giving that number of cows are 5. Retention time is something to 20 days. Temperature is 30 degrees Celsius. Okay. Dry matter consumed is 2 kg per day. That is the amount of matter which is consumed per day, which is 2 kg per day. Biogas yield, the amount of biogas which is actually produced per meter cube per kg. It is given in meter cube per kg. So this is basically given the volume of the biogas produced per unit mass. Efficiency of the burner which is used for production of the biogas is having this MH efficiency, that is 60%. It is only 60% efficient. Methane proportion is 0.8. Heat of the combustion of the methane is 28 megajoule per meter cube. Density of the material is 50. Now you must be thinking, when you saw this question, you must be thinking that you have to use all this data. No, you don't have to use all this data. You have to just provide the power available from the digester. What is the digester? It is a biogas digester. What is the output of the digester? It is the biogas, right? So to find the output of the this digester, what you have to do is here, you have to firstly find the total dry matter. See, dry matter consumed is 2 kg per day, but the number of cows are given 5. So this is the dry matter consumed from one cow. So total number of cows are 5. So total dry matter will be equal to 5 into 2 kg per day. That is, it is equal to 10 kg per day. Right? That is the amount of raw material, that is the dry matter, which is from 5 cows. Now, it is given the biogas yield is 0.24 meter cube per kg. Biogas yield is 0.24 meter cube per kg. So volume of biogas will be equal to how much? What is the volume of biogas? This is given the biogas yield. That is 0.24 meter cube per kg. If you multiply with this kg, you will get the volume of the biogas in meter cube per day. That is 0.24 into 10 meter cube per day. So per day, 2.4 meter cube per day volume of biogas is produced. Now in this biogas, the major composition of the biogas is what? Methane is the major composition, and that is given here 0.8. So you have to find the amount of methane, because the major source of power from biogas is methane, right? So you have to multiply this volume of methane. Volume of methane will be equal to 0.8 into 2.4 meter cube per day. Now this is the volume of the methane which we are getting. Now you have to define the power output. Power output can be determined by multiplying this volume with heat of the combustion of the methane into efficiency of the burner. Those who have not used this efficiency of the burner, they have got the incorrect answer. They must have got the incorrect answer. So you have to multiply this heat of combustion of the methane into the biogas yield, because you have to find this in megajoule per day. This is in meter cube per day. So if you multiply this with megajoule per meter cube, you can study from the unit, you will get the answer. So you have to multiply this with, the power consumption will be equal to 0.8 into 2.4 into 28 into 0.6. You will get the answer. That will be equal to approximately 32.256 megajoule per day. Approximately, this will be option C, that is 32.3. So, how many of you understood the solution? Yes. Tell me. Have you understood the solution? Yes, please say yes or no. If you have not understood, I can explain it again. So, you just have to do one thing. You have to find the total amount of dry matter. Then you have to find the amount of volume of the biogas. Okay. After that, you have to find the volume of the methane, because basically in the biogas, the major constituent is methane. So you have to find the volume of the methane. Now this you are getting in meter cube per day. The answer you required in, even if you don't understand what you have to do, you know that the answer is in megajoule per day. This is in meter cube per day. You have to multiply this with heat of combustion, you will get the answer. But the efficiency of the burner is not 100%. Burner is only 60% efficient. So you have to multiply this with 0.6. Then only you will get the answer. Understood, everyone? Good. I think this is the last question. This was also asked in the exam of ESC 2019. What are the advantages of biomass? See, one question was from the limitation of the solar energy. Another question was from the advantage of the biomass, and was for numerical from biogas. Okay. So that is why in this lecture I have taken, majorly I have taken biomass, biogas, solar energy and hydrogen fuel. And some little bit information about other coal bed methane shale. So because I think this time they can ask you question from shale gas and coal bed methane also. Yes. Please read the statement carefully and give the right answer. What are the advantages? They are asking about the advantage and they are asking about the correct statement. So whenever you see any question in the exam from general study, you have to firstly see here whether they are asking about the advantage or limitation. And the second thing that you have to see here is whether they are asking about the correct answer or incorrect answer. Correct? You have to find whether they are asking about the correct answer or incorrect answer. Then only you will be able to get the right answer, because you have to read these two things carefully. Okay. So first statement is storage and transmission is possible. Storage and transportation is possible. Second is it is ecologically safe and is inoffensive. Biomass can be developed with present man and material ability. Low capital input required. Yes, what is the right answer? I can see most of you are getting option D. Some of you are saying option B. That is 1, 2 and 3. Someone is saying 2 and 3 and 4. Yes. So, the right answer for this question is option C, 1, 3 and 4. First thing is, its storage and transportation is possible. If storage is possible, so its transportation of biomass is also possible. You can transport the biomass very easily. There is no problem with transportation. It is ecologically safe and is inoffensive. Is it it is ecologically safe? No. About the biogas, you can say that it is environmental friendly. But you cannot say that biomass is environmental friendly. You cannot say that. You cannot say that biomass is ecologically safe. No, it is not ecologically safe and inoffensive. It is bit offensive for the environment. You cannot say it for the, why? Because you know that the waste of the plant, they have some bad smell. The animal and human excreta, the municipal waste have this bad smell. That they are not good for the, ecologically they are not safe for the environment. Right? So biomass is not safe, biogas is safe, environmentally safe. These are two different things. So second statement is not correct. The third statement is correct. Can be developed with present man and material ability. Yes, that can be developed. We just required man and material. Low capital required. Yes, low capital is required. Okay. So the right answer will be option C. The correct statement is 1, 3 and 4. Second is not correct. Okay. So these were few questions and the concept that I have to give you for the, your from the topic of energy and this conservation. Initially in this lecture, I thought that all you guys must be serious about this paper, but I also found some nuisance in the lecture. I got some of the students who were not serious about this, or you are not preparing for this exam. Maybe your direction is somewhere else. So such kind of mischievous students normally comes in the lecture. So we have to deal with them, no problem. Yes, they play with the words, Arunendra Mishra, very, that is correct. The question are very simple, right? These are all basic approaches, basic things that you all have covered in your BTech. All the 10 topics, mathematics, aptitude, energy environment, material science, or we can say this, this project management, total quality management, all you have studied in your BTech. Even ethics. Ethics is something that even you don't even need to study. You don't need to study ethics. That should be inside you. So those students who are not, they are using bad words here. Those who are not, they actually don't know the meaning of ethics. For an engineer, ethics is the most important thing. So if you have to be an IAS officer, you should have some ethics in you. So those students who are not having this ethics, they should not join the lecture. Okay? Because I have seen some of the students who are creating some nonsense during the lecture. This is my request to everyone. Either you get serious for your studies. GradeUp is not like other platform where you can just see anything and you can just be in the channel. Okay, it's my request to everyone. This is only for study purpose. Don't need to create any nonsense here. All right. And for all those students who have enjoyed this session, who have liked this session, who have got benefited from this session, that is really good. And this was the first lecture of energy environment. I hope I have tried to cover the concepts that of few topics because I cannot cover each and everything in 2 hours, right? So from this topic of energy and this conservation, I have tried to cover some few topics and we have discussed few questions. I have also given you the hint how to solve the question in the exam. Okay, the question will be very simple. You have to read the question, the statement and the answer which is required or the options. Okay, so I will see you tomorrow with another lecture on energy, environment and its conservation. That will be provided to you, that will meet you tomorrow at 4 p.m. And the next lecture will be tomorrow. After that, we will have another lecture on Saturday. That will be on environmental pollution and degradation. So we are going to have total 6 lectures in this YouTube series for Engineering Services 2020 preparation for GS under the topic of energy environment. Okay. See you tomorrow at 4 p.m. Those who are not getting the PDF so far, I will request my team for providing you the PDF. Okay. So don't worry, have some patience. ISRO mock solution, mega mock solution will be at 6:30 p.m. today. So see you there. Yeah, see you there at 6:30 p.m. Till then, thank you and have a good day. Thank you. See you tomorrow at 6 p.m. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel if you have not subscribed to it. Because if in the YouTube channel, those who really want to prepare for these examination like ESC, ISRO, GATE, and some other examination, please don't forget to subscribe the channel. If you have liked the content, do like the video and share it to your friends. See you in some other session, that is tomorrow. Thank you and have a good day. Thank you.